coming out for DinoFest 2023. I'm Nate Smith. I'm the curator here at the Dinosaur Institute. And I hope you've really been enjoying all the displays that we have, the specimens we have out, the programs that are going on. And thank you also for coming out to this little seminar series. And we like to use this as an opportunity to talk about the active research that takes place at our institution as a natural history museum. So we are very much a place that is not just kind of showing and telling you stories about our natural world and Earth history, but we're the place that's actually creating those new stories as well through the creation of new knowledge and our research endeavors across dozens of different departments. And in my institute, the Dinosaur Institute, with my colleague Luis Chiappe, we're out collecting new dinosaurs from every era of the, or every period of the Mesozoic, and pursuing research on all aspects of dinosaur evolution, from their origins to their evolution into birds. And we brought some speakers here today that kind of are good colleagues of ours that work on some of these projects, including, you know, many triassicophiles, including my colleague Dr. Jessica Whiteside, who studies ancient climates, ancient paleoecology, ancient atmospheres, and even uses ancient biomolecules to tell us things about mass extinction events, about animal and world ecology back during the Triassic period. And Jess comes to us from recently the University of Southampton, where she's chatting with a couple of folks in southern England. But we are really, really glad that she is officially now started as the chair of the Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences, much closer to us in San Diego State University. So don't be surprised if we drag her out again for another one of these talks. But we heard a little bit about kind of the origin of dinosaurs and what got them going from kind of the organismal, the animal side of things. And now Jess is going to kind of set the stage a little bit more about what this world was like and how it was changing. So please welcome Dr. Jessica Whiteside.
Thank you, Nate. Thank you for everyone coming. It's really a pleasure to be here for DinoFest. As Nate said, I am a card carrying, in a way, hand-holding triassicophile. I often give students multiple choice questions where literally every answer is the Triassic. And while I've worked throughout the geological time scale, I always find myself coming back to the Triassic. So I hope I can excite you on that perspective as well, because it's not just important because of the rise of dinosaurs, but that global backdrop in terms of its end member in our geography and climate and why dinosaurs actually rose. So with that, I just wanted to tell you that our thought about this is actually fundamentally changing in just the last couple of years with research that we've been conducting with the number of people in the room. So my colleague, Dr. Randy Ermus, who spoke earlier today, and my colleague, Dr. Nate Smith, you just heard from. It was typically thought that dinosaurs were heat-loving, loved to be in jungle-like, steamy environments, and these are the characterization of the late Triassic, so the first period in the age of dinosaurs. But our understanding of how they've co-evolved with climate is dramatically different, shockingly so. So it turns out, and the punchline is really here, that the secret to their survival and global domination is at the expense of crocodile-like creatures may have actually been this layer of fuzz that you see on them here. So crocodile-like creatures, well, they're all naked, and I'm going to tell you about how they actually got through by sneakily burrowing into things, whereas dinosaurs rose because they were proto-adapted by their fuzzy bits. And those hot tropics, where we typically thought dinosaurs loved these hot, hot worlds of 120 degrees Fahrenheit, no, actually they were inhospitable to dinosaurs, or at least the high metabolic plant-loving types, for 35 million years. So I'm going to talk to you about, again, that climate background. And I love this example here because it shows you a great exemplar. So this is a feathered carnivorous dinosaur. He's sneaking off with a mammal, quite happy with his prey. He's covered in fuzz. This is Centaurus. That's his mammal victim. And you can see in the background a volcano. So these are massive fissure eruptions like the kind that happened in Iceland that halt planes. But the scene is actually more, it should have been more like, advance my screen here. Let's see. Oops, it's not advancing this part. Oh, there we go. Okay. So the scene should really be like this. It's actually those volcanoes, yes, they throw heat trapping gases like carbon dioxide and methane into the atmosphere, but they actually also throw up something called sulfur aerosols, which results in freezing conditions. And it's those freeze snaps that actually let dinosaurs take a foothold and globally dominant. Like, they spread everywhere after this mass extinction event. Naked crocodile-like creatures go extinct. So that's really the punchline here, and I want to tell you about how we actually go about understanding this. Now, this is a lesson in two parts. The beauty for me and the fossil record is that it teaches us about our present and future world as well. So when we look out in the modern world around us, every natural thing, it actually has a very long story about it. When we look out at birds today, well, that's the story of dinosaurs, and we're going to focus in on the Triassic and Jurassic. The first part is telling you about the hot period of the late Triassic. So it was really, really hot. The tropics were about 120 degrees. Dinosaurs, only carnivorous dinosaurs do well. We heard from Dr. Ermus earlier. They're only 10% of the ecosystem. So they were a minor component. There were other fierce creatures doing the exact same things that we typically think of dinosaurs doing. And then part two is about cold snap. So this is the new work that's really dinosaurs rise because they were pro-adapted because they happen to have feathers. The Triassic itself, like I said, and multiple choice exams in my classes, it's always the Triassic, because it is the end member. It is so important in terms of understanding geography, in terms of climate. It's a time where all the continents were coalesced into the supercontinent Pangaea. It's broadly shaped like Pac-Man, if you remember that video game archive. It's taking a bite out of the Tethys Ocean, and the other ocean you see here is the Panthalassic Ocean. So everything was united. It was so, so hot, though, that we have something missing from our fundamental world now. We don't have ice caps on the South Pole. We don't have ice caps on the North Pole. And because we don't have ice caps, it means that sea level was actually very different than it is today. There was a lot of terrestrial land. Theoretically, an ambitious tetrapod could have actually walked from pole to pole in one single lifetime. But we're going to talk about that actually didn't happen. So it's a surprising world as well. When we think about the climate of the Triassic, it's critical for our modern and future warming world. And that is because we're looking up here at a curve that looks a little complicated, but basically we're looking at the modern world here, and we're going back 300 million years, and we're just looking at how CO2 has been really, really high. And this white bar here, these are the predicted values of atmospheric CO2, so that greenhouse, that heat-trapping gas that causes things to warm. And that's what we're really worried about, is these kind of tipping points that happen here. But this is just to tell you that our modern world, it's been said, the further we go into our future, the further back in time we actually go to find a world like that. And it turns out that if we actually burn all conventional and non-conventional resources on our planet, it takes us to the Triassic. So that would be the ultimate world we would go into. Also important, why it's on the multiple choice exam, right? So values of CO2 up at 6,000 ppm. Our modern world is 420, so it's much, much higher CO2, a much, much hotter world. Well, just like today, there are measurable consequences of warming our planet. One of them is an increase in the frequency and intensity of wildfires. So those of us in Southern California, and now that I've just moved here, I've already seen one wildfire, but you know that how prevalent they are. This is the same thing that would happen in the Triassic, and I'm going to show you how we actually have evidence for this happening over and over and over again. As my colleague, Dr. Randy Ermus, talked about earlier today, we're also talking about a transitional interval between two major mass extinction events. And we can see that just by these dips on this curve that's just showing you the number of genera of small shelly fossils in the world's oceans and these two big dips here. So it's that interval in between this transitional period that saw the rise of dinosaurs. It wasn't just dinosaurs, though. This is an unparalleled eruption of life on our planet. So it's a monumental evolutionary event where lots of things come on the scene. Our complete idea of what our terrestrial ecosystems in the modern world are, everything had its origin back in the Triassic. Remember, it's always safe to answer Triassic on multiple choice questions. So that's whether you're talking about a crocodile, whether you're talking about lizards or turtles, mammals that were small and burrowing, and then dinosaurs that are with us now as birds. So this would be what their Triassic components will look like. You can see that, you know, crocodiles are there. They're a little more gracile looking. Birds are early dinosaurs. And it's been said that being in the Triassic is like visiting the intergalactic bar in Star Wars, because the characters all look weird, but they're vaguely familiar. Like, you would know with Sesame Street taxonomy what these guys were. The resemblances are usually superficial, and you have some trouble figuring out what everyone's saying. But most of all, what you need to know is that every one of these guys will kill you if you look at them. And we've got another character that comes out in the Triassic, and that's pterosaurs. So they come in and they fly out of land into the into the Cretaceous. So that's the scene that we're setting here. Now, I said this is a story in two parts. So the first part is about some like it a little less hot. That's dinosaurs. They don't really like it hot like we think they do. Crocodile-like creatures do. And my colleague Randy showed you these pictures, because they were from a press release that our colleague and friend Victor Leshek drew. And this is showing you a scene in the Triassic. So this is a scene that's showing you armored eidosaurs, two phytosaurs over here with, you know, a dead departed part of that family in the ground, a mouth open to one of them, and we have the sneaky little coelophysis thinking he's running away from wildfires, but he's a small guy. He's a minor component in that ecosystem. And this is actually where we actually go to extract our rocks. So we need to look at places that have a great fossil record of early dinosaurs and their competitors. Brandy shared some of these with you. This place is the Chinle Formation in the Southwest US, and we're looking at Ghost Ranch, New Mexico. I also wanted to say that for my line of work, it's really cool to me because in this picture, this is an artist's depiction of the scene in the Triassic, but we actually have evidence for every single thing in this picture that you see. Whether it's the organisms that you see, to the wildfire, to these little stream deposits, we actually have that in the fossil record. We just have to learn to read the rocks and use the right kind of tools. So I'm going to introduce you to a few new tools that aren't just looking at bottle fossils, although obviously those are critical as well. You've been introduced to the Triassic earlier in Dr. Ermes's talk, so we're talking about this kind of 235 million years, up to 200 million years, that's the Triassic. We have the Jurassic here, so we're going to talk about two things, the Ghost Ranch section in terms of dinosaurs not liking it hot and there being wildfires, and then we're going to talk about the intra-Triassic extinction, where we have a big fundamental change from dinosaurs being 10% of the ecosystem to basically spreading throughout the world like weeds. Cute furry weeds, but weeds nonetheless. And I also want to reorient you in terms of what we're talking about in climate space. So remember, we're talking about a world, here's our modern CO2 here in blue, and these are the values in the Triassic. So much, 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 much higher CO2, much, much warmer conditions. And over here on the upper right will be pictures of our famous Pac-Man Pangaea showing you the locations as we travel around the globe to these various sites. Now during this time we said, it's so hot there are no ice caps at either pole. So that means that we have forested areas going all the way up into the poles. It's really, truly fantastic. The poles would look very different. So it's lush vegetation, things that in the modern world would be considered intolerant to frost. So things like cycads and palm trees. And I'm so glad that for the first time in my life, I have some in my front yard. That's what the world looked like actually at 60 degrees north, at 70 degrees north in the Arctic Circle. So it looks very, very different. But I want to point out one other thing, and that is that just because it's a hothouse world does not mean that the temperature was the same across the globe. It doesn't mean that there's less variable climate. So we'll talk a little bit about that as well. This is actually something that was originally taken from an airplane showing you the states lined out where Ghost Ranch actually fits out. So the Chinle Formation is part of this Choma Basin here. It's in the American Southwest, beautiful badlands, areas that you like to think that like out in old westerns, bandits used to hide out, that kind of thing in those badlands. It's adjacent to the Colorado Plateau and it's just on the, it's just north of Albuquerque. The Chinle Formation itself is famous for fossils, so you've probably seen petrified wood before that comes from Petrified Forest National Park. This is actually showing you a winterscape. By the way, happy equinox, welcome to fall. So it's showing you some light dusting here of snow here. But this badland typography that you see, that is typical of the Chinle Formation. And we've seen this from Dr. Ermes as well. So this is a typical scene in the late Triassic in the low latitudes, so in the tropical regions. And we talked about before, dinosaurs are there. They're not the top predators. Here's a dinosaur here. Here's a dinosaur actually being eaten by a phytosaur. So they're not a major component of this system. Before dinosaurs ruled, after the major mass extinction event, there were equally fearsome animals. That's what you see everything else going on around here. And they're taking care of business in similar ways that the dinosaurs did while dinosaurs remained small and not really major components of their ecosystem. The Choma Basin again. So here are these badlands in these gray bands. Here are fossiliferous localities, and there are lots of quarries. Here's another map just showing you all these things that are labeled. Those are quarries that have been producing hundreds to thousands of specimens of crocodile-like creatures, dinosaurs, not a major component of the system, but dinosaur cousins. And it also has things like really cool, like Taua. So if you haven't seen Taua in the main exposition center, make sure that's on your list today. Dinosaur bone, types of dinosaur bones or Dromaeosaurid bones here. This is from an enigmatic Triassic reptile Van Clevia that looked a little like a swimming dragon, but tiny. Really cool preservation of the bones. And then we also have pollen and spores here. For my line of business, looking at molecular fossils, which I'll get into a bit, when you see pollen and spores, your eyes light up because you know that there's a good chance that you can find your molecular fossils there as well and tell a story, which is what I'm going to be doing, about climate. So here's a view of the chimney area. And this right here, this is the chimney formation that we're going to look at a bit more detail. If you had an opportunity to go down to Chinle, you know that at Ghost Ranch, this was made famous by the American painter George O'Keefe, who painted these wonderful scenes. Here's a scene she actually painted. She also painted a lot of cow skulls when she wasn't imbibing in extracurricular activities, like riding around on motorcycles and being just a really cool woman. You can see her house there at Ghost Ranch. And we're going to start building our data set. So the slides are going to get a little bit more busy, but I'm going to walk you through the panels. The patterns are actually super clear, so I just want to introduce you first, and Dr. Hermes showed this part briefly. This is a graph that's just showing you all the different beds. These are actually kind of the true colors of the beds that we're looking at, and it's showing you the late Triassic going from older age stuff at the bottom to younger age stuff at the top. Just like if you used to throw newspapers on the ground and they would accumulate through time, that's what we're looking at here. We have here to the right just some of the quarries where the fossils are coming from, and then we have here lines that are showing you the extent of key reptile groups. Some of them go through, lineages continue into the Jurassic, a crocodile-like creature, the line that goes on to real crocodiles, and then the line of dinosaurs. But remember, dinosaurs were a minor component, only 10% of this ecosystem. They're very, very rare, and it's the dinosaur relatives and the crocodile-like creatures that are the really abundant ones in this ecosystem. But we have those same types of reptiles living among each other for like 20 million years. We're going to start building in our chemical record so that we looked at something called carbon isotopes. And they basically tell you about a little bit about like kind of what the ecosystem is doing. And the important thing to note is that this ecosystem is wobbling back and forth, back and forth. Some have called this like a drunken sailor. It's that kind of thing. It's not a straight line. What does that mean? Well, it means that the climate is changing during this time. That's our first clue. We can get things a little bit more sophisticated. So here are cores that go through a similar interval of time, and we see something right here. Now, it looks like kind of like a pebble. It's not actually a pebble. It's a carbonate concretion. It's a fossilized soil. And that fossilized soil is really cool because it tells you about the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So we look at carbon and oxygen isotopes, and it can actually give you the atmospheric CO2 210 million years ago, which is truly phenomenal. So when we look at that and plot it, we can see CO2 is rising as we go through our section, and dramatically so. We can look at pollen and spores, and again, the just important thing here is that they're wobbling all over the place. They're actually matching the other lines. So we're just looking, things are going up and things are coming down. It's basically telling you that we have aridity coming and humidity coming. So there's a change kind of in the water cycle during this time, and that is following CO2, and that is following our indicators that something is going on with the climate. There are wildfires, and wildfires in abundance, and the most obvious way we know this is that there's actually charcoal remains. So the charcoal looks like this. And when you look at the charcoal under a microscope, it reflects out some light, and the amount of reflected light that goes back actually tells you how hot that wildfire was actually burning. Again, really cool that we can actually deduce all this from rocks that are 210 million years old. When we look at those, we see that there are kind of three sections that look like they had wildfires, and they're burning at super, super hot temperatures. 680 degrees, well, it's easy to throw out numbers. That's three times as hot as your stove. That's how hot these wildfires were burning. So they're burning everything around it. And then we have to think again, okay, so they're burning all these things, and we said that we have an issue with the dinosaurs. We only have meat-eating dinosaurs here. They're probably only meat-eating dinosaurs because all the vegetation keeps getting burned. So there's nothing for them to eat. They're high metabolic rate organisms. They're warm-blooded organisms, and they need to have some vegetation to eat, and there is none. So you get stuck with these like small, cute, but small meat-eating kinds and no herbivorous kinds. Well, we have other indications that wildfires were going on, and this is from my specialty, which is molecular fossils. So where there are actual molecules that get preserved in the fossil record as well. I like to tell people, like, we hear diamonds are forever, but actually molecules are forever. So the earliest life we even know on our planet comes from molecular fossils. When we think of normal fossils, and this is an ichthyosaur depicted kind of going into a riverbed, decomposing and dying, it gets entombed into the rock record as a skeleton, right? So there's a body fossil of it. Well, what also happens is that other parts of it, actually at the cell level here, inside of every cell that's in an animal, there's this lipid protein stuff here. If you've heard of drugs like Lipitor, that's actually what these are. They're fat types of molecules. And that gets embedded in the rock record as well. So here's a modern one, and here's what its fossil counterpart looks like. And it actually, they're really cool. So in this case, we have pigmented ones, and they can actually tell you the color of things. So in the modern day, when we find it in the record, we're actually extracting molecules through chemical processes, and we can extrapolate back telescopically, really, back into the ancient world and reconstruct what was going on. Well, what can we reconstruct from our molecular fossils? Well, we can tell you actually the type of organism that was present at a microbial scale. We can tell you the environmental conditions when that fossil was laid down. We can tell you the temperature, and we can tell you actually even the pigments, so the color of organisms. Some dinosaur feathers, actually molecules are run on them, and you know the color, like that it had a red crest, or that some ichthyosaurs had other pigments on it. It's really it's just fascinating, but this all comes from molecular fossils. So we like to read the rock from multiple layers. When we actually get them, we go through several, it's basically, you use something that's like a fancy espresso machine that under high temperature and high pressure, you extract out these molecules. Just like if you're drinking coffee, you're extracting out a molecule, a compound, and that is caffeine. And this way, we're actually extracting out, in this picture, these ringed looking things. All these rings are actually just to do something called polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. The only reason they're important in this story is that they are the markers of burning vegetation. So if you think about when you smell something burning, what you're smelling is actually a compound. Remember, those compounds, molecules are forever. It gets embedded in the rock, and we can dig it up 10, 15, 100, 100 million years later and actually tell you that wildfire was there. So they indicate that there's fire happening and that burnt landscape is susceptible to flooding. So these poor dinosaurs, these poor creatures, what were they going through? Well, it was probably inhospitable to them in the tropics because it's constantly burning. And then that results in areas that are susceptible to floods. So it's flooding, and then it's burning, and it's flooding, and it's burning, back and forth, back and forth. So you're not establishing an ecosystem that has lush vegetation for herbivorous dinosaurs to munch on. And you have a system that's really carnivory. And that's because carnivory is a little bit more of a quick, dirty, easy way to get caloric intake than actually evolving a means of digesting plants. But when we look at our molecular fossils, we can actually see, this is just showing you that through the section, we had from charcoal remains, we had these three intervals saying that there's wildfires. But when we look at the molecular level, you can see that there's lots of wildfires going through all through this system as dinosaurs are trying to rise but remaining thwarted in small components of the ecosystem. So that's the story from the western part of the United States. Now if we switch to the eastern part of the United States, to the affectionately named Grand Canyon in the state of Connecticut. No joke, there really is a Grand Canyon in the state of Connecticut. It doesn't look like a hole in the ground. It looks like this. And that's because it's one of the best places in the world to look at the way that our orbit as we go around the sun changes water levels and actually changes the climate and the seasons. So by the way, again, happy equinox. So this is kind of what's going on here is that these steps you see, there are three things that repeat. These black layers here is telling you that it's a deep lake, really humid. They actually repeat by something called the precession of the equinoxes. The best explanation of this is actually from the writer of Curious George, who is an amateur astronomer and wrote a book called The Stars, and he talks about how this works. But basically, seasonality, the changes in the season, are displayed in the fossil record as well, in the geological record. And in this case, we're looking at lakes that go up and down. The water level goes up and down and up and down. They basically go from a very deep, deep lake, like almost like a mini ocean type of thing, to basically a dried out playa. And in the rock record, when we learn to read rocks, this is what they look like. So in a deep water lake, we have lots of organic carbon stuff present, these lines that go around, and you have preservation of fish and this kind of thing. So it's a deep, deep lake, fish are swimming in there. When we're at a shallow lake, we have things like dinosaur footprints, right? Because they can actually walk on the shoreline and leave them. We have desiccation cracks indicating that actually the water completely dried up. And we have these things like stromatolites, which are actually, in this case, growing over dead trees that are on the edge of the lakes. And these microbial things just encrust all over them. In the modern world, we have examples of them encrusting over Coke cans. 200 million years ago, we didn't have the Coke cans, so we have them encrusting over trees. And this is one of the lines of evidence that we use to actually look. So we're going back on our record for 35 million years, and we're trying to see again, how does the climate change over this interval that sees the origin of dinosaurs? My colleague, Dr. Ermes, told you this was something that happened in the Triassic. Then we have this 25 million year period where we have dinosaurs on the scene, but they're not major components of the ecosystem. And then we have this mass extinction event and they spread like weeds. So the climate backdrop, the first thing we look at is this idea of the long-term change in terms of the monsoon conditions of how the water cycle plays up. And all to say, it goes up and down and up and down. And it's tuned to the orbital cycles of the Earth, changing its axis and tilt and its position as it goes around the sun. You may have heard or seen the play Hair. There's a song that's like the Age of Aquarius. That's what I'm talking about. That actually plays out in the rocks. Really, really cool stuff. So these are just some students that have worked with me on this as undergraduates in the lab. Again, all we're doing is looking at wet, dry cycles as it goes through this interval. And what can we say? Well, the lake cycles go up and down. We also, again, looked at reconstructing atmospheric carbon dioxide. And you can see the record here. The important thing is just that the two curves look the same. They look the same throughout the entire record. That tells us that atmospheric carbon dioxide tracks the lake level cycle. So we're starting to tell more of a story about how environmental change, how climate change works as a backdrop to the age of dinosaurs. We can also actually deduce temperature. So we can deduce temperature from little fossils that are swimming around in the oceans, and the temperature curve looks the same. Hot, cold, if it's hot, high CO2, and we have lake levels that are actually higher because there's an intensification of the hydrological cycle, and so the story continues to fit. When it's higher temperature, we can also look at different kinds of chemical fossils that tells us the amount of erosion. So what's actually being thrown back into the oceans, another actual kill mechanism. Again, the important thing is that all the curves look the same. Really great for my line of business. It's not always so clear. Usually it's a little more nuanced than this. And finally, we can look at the water cycle itself to reconstruct humid air conditions by looking at molecules from leaf wax that are preserved in the record. So if you use chapstick and put that on your lips, you know how it feels like really waxy? All leaves have a cuticle on them that's like that wax. And when they die, that wax gets dispersed and you can actually, again, molecularly tap into it and look at the isotopes and actually get a signal of the water. So all the stories fitting together. We have a water cycle with repeated sudden and arid intervals. So there's drought and then there's flooding. And that goes on and off and on and off all the way through the late Triassic. We've talked about Pangaea. So here's another reconstruction of Pangaea, but now we're actually looking at how plants play out on Pangaea. And one of the most striking aspects of this late Triassic world, we said in the beginning, an ambitious tetrapod could have walked from pole to pole, but that didn't happen. And why didn't that happen? If geographically, really, the tetrapod could have done it. But it doesn't happen because there are these temperature gradients on average that create these climate envelopes or bands. It's called biotic provinciality. It's just a fancy way of saying that there are bands or envelopes that restrict the movement of animals, like tetrapods, like dinosaurs, and it restricts the movement of plants as well. So we have these humid arid zones and they switch, and you can see these are color-coded showing you the plants, and the plants are not the same. It's not even the same plants if you go to two different arid intervals. They're fundamentally different. They're zoned out like this, and this is for the plants, but it's also true for the tetrapods. Let's look specifically at dinosaurs. So for land-dwelling animals, the provinciality is even more extreme, and it's best seen with the herbivorous dinosaurs, so the plant-eating dinosaurs. We said before, dinosaurs evolved in the very earliest part of the late Triassic, but herbivorous dinosaurs don't become common until about 225 million years ago, and amongst the most common fossils, but only at the high latitudes, so up here. You don't see them in the tropics. In fact, there's not a single specimen of an herbivorous dinosaur in the entire Triassic, and that's from looking at thousands and thousands of specimens. No herbivorous dinosaurs. Instead, in the low latitudes, you have these type of guys. So these are pseudosuchians, they're crocodile relatives. They're the most dominant herbivores. They're also the most dominant carnivores. They're the ones depicted usually eating coelophysis for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They are the fierce creatures. They are the top predators. They're the apex predators. And you can see, like in this reconstruction of one here, you can see that it has heavy jaws, it has strong running legs, it's reminiscent of large dinosaurs, but it's not a dinosaur. They go extinct at the end of the Triassic with no descendants, while dinosaurs grow in size and variety. Now, when we were talking about in the high latitudes, you do have plant-eating dinosaurs. This is an example. So from Europe, and Dr. Irmish showed you this, so it's somewhat of a reinforcement of that. These are skeletons of a famous dinosaur called Plateosaurus. They're the most common four-legged animals in Europe. And we suspect that that highly variable climate that we are mentioning in the tropics, that extreme wildfires, doesn't establish populations of these kind of high metabolic herbivorous dinosaurs in the tropics because the wildfires keep killing off the plants that are needed, whereas in the high latitudes we have the plants there so the herbivores can actually eat and thrive. And again, they're like the most abundant tetrapods that are there. They got up really large, like the size of like big monster trucks kind of thing. So the summary of part one, well, ancient riverbeds of the western U.S. show that there are extreme and frequent environmental conditions in the tropics. Temperatures are at 120 degrees. They alternate from wildfires to flooding. High atmospheric CO2 drove these intervals that promote extensive wildfires. High atmospheric CO2 is linked to precipitation and evaporation extremes, temperature extremes, weathering, erosion, and it indirectly suppresses the rise of dinosaurs. So that brings us to part two. Okay, so they're suppressed in terms of diversity, but then we have eruptions of massive volcanoes, and my colleague showed this slide as well, but we have some things surviving. So here are the sauropods here, and here are these massive volcanic eruptions. And when we look at how things play out in the Jurassic world, we're looking at small carnivorous dinosaurs, herbivores from the long-necked sauropods, as well as the ornithischians that go on to be things like stegosaurus and duck-billed dinosaurs and that kind of thing. And you can see that they're all over the place. So global domination by dinosaurs, and why is that? Well, the pattern also is reminiscent of something that we see today. This isn't normal. It's happening today because of humans carrying everything everywhere. So if you haven't heard of the spotted lanternfly, it's taking over all the eastern United States and it's moving towards the Midwest. So if you haven't seen it yet, you have this note coming soon to a neighborhood near you. A little threatening, but you know, a little paleo humor. But seriously, like these things just spread off, and that's what dinosaurs did in the early Jurassic. But why again? Why did that happen? And you heard earlier today, was it competition? Was it the environment? Was it luck? Some of this clues is actually coming from a 1920s poem by the American poet Robert Frost. It says, "Some say the world went in fire, some say in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. But if I had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction, ice is also great and would suffice." And that's what happens to dinosaurs. It's really the ice story. So again, land-dwelling animals, extinction at the end Triassic, it depends how you look at it, but it was very severe, and in some ways more severe than that great dying event at the end Permian. It affects marine organisms, it affects land animals, and again, though, why? So let's go back to how these volcanoes are actually working, because we've already told you that it's a story about volcanoes. What happens with these volcanoes? First, it's not like a cone-shaped volcano that we typically think of in postcards. In fact, these are so deadly and devastating, it's not even worth mentioning the two in the same sentence. These are huge cracks in the earth, so big, so large, they actually are in part related to opening up the Atlantic Ocean. And you can see that they're displayed here, all in red here, showing you how extensive it is. This is 11 million square kilometers, meaning this is the largest volcanic eruption in the entire solar system. That would cover one-third the size of the moon, the entire continental United States, all of Europe, whether you include Brexit or not in the UK or whatever, anything you want to include, it covers everywhere. But what happens actually from a chemical standpoint, and these are just showing you, this is in Iceland showing you these fissure eruptions. You have lava curtains going up into the stratosphere, into the troposphere, above where you would fly on an airplane. And the story is related to the chemicals, the gases that are coming out. So we talked before, carbon dioxide is one, and methane. These are heat-trapping greenhouse gases, and they come out. They come out whether they're coming out directly from the Earth's mantle up into the atmosphere, or whether they're actually wiggling their way around through the local country rock. In some areas, we have local country rock that's gypsum. This is a type of salt. And if hot stuff goes up through there, it actually releases some sulfur dioxide. Sulfur dioxide is a cooling agent. It's something that we were very concerned about in the 1980s about putting a hole in the ozone layer in Antarctica. So that's why there were bans on aerosol containers, because they're sulfur particles that go up and they block sunlight. So it's a double whammy when we're talking about volcanism. There's heat, so some things are going to die from heat, but there's cooling. And the reason that they're both, and the reason that you see differences in the types of selective organisms that can get through, has to do with the residence time or the lifetime of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere compared to sulfur dioxide. Sulfur has very short cold snaps. It just is in there for about 2 years, and then it's gone. But you can kill a lot of things in 2 years. Carbon dioxide and methane have very long periods well, actually, methane immediately converts to carbon dioxide, but carbon dioxide is there for hundreds of years. In fact, it's always been said, like, we don't even know the effect from the Industrial Revolution, because we still have a lag, but that carbon dioxide still hasn't actually made its way out of the back into the cycle. So we don't really know. So carbon dioxide, long-term effects. Sulfur, cooling, short-term effects. And that gets us to timing is everything. Well, that means that what happens at this extinction event, what happens at different time intervals? Within a day, some things are going to die just locally, because there's going to be a volcanic dust that comes out, and just by the sheer momentum and stress and strain, it's just going to kill things in the vicinity. On the weeks to decades, you're going to have volcanic winters. This is where you would have population decline, migration between, and this has to do with short-term cooling episodes, and we'll get into that in a bit. On centuries to millennia, so for hundreds to thousands of years, there's going to be warming. So that will be extinctions. There are some things that can't be hot, basically, which is why if you have a fever of a couple of degrees Fahrenheit, you're in dire straits. But if you go in for surgery, they're going to drop your body temperature to 50 to 60 degrees and you'll be fine, because life lives closer to its higher lethal threshold than its lower. And then on millions of years, that's when you have evolution, radiations, and this type of thing, and actual new ecosystem norms. So what do we see? Well, for heat stuff, we see pre-extinction, we have plants that are really thriving with these big leaves, these little holes that allow for gas exchange. They look really nice and normal. That's in low CO2 before the extinction. Here's the extinction here. You can see what happens to the plants. It's the same kind of thing. They feel the heat significantly. They get shorter leaves, 3 to 5 times shorter. And then what they use to actually allow for gas to come in looks all shrunk and hairy and sick looking. Dinosaurs, well, we said dinosaurs, they thrive. You have a 30% increase in the footprints. That means a doubling of mass. So dinosaurs get huge. They go everywhere. Bring us back to, well, why again the dinosaurs? And this has to do with the sulfur aerosols, the sulfur dioxide that goes into aerosols. And here's just a modern example looking at a volcano. So one that we actually have records from human lifespans. This is one that happened in a densely populated area, so in Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines in 1991. And you can see up here this massive cloud of gases coming out. This is actually the sulfur aerosols coming out. What happens is you get high-speed avalanches. It throws out hot ash. It throws out gas. There are giant mud flows. These gases go up in hundreds of miles across. And the sulfur aerosols go up into the atmosphere, and they actually create little kind of ice crystals that block sunlight coming in. So it results in cooling, and it results in vegetation not being able to get through. Because it's actually basically those crystal-like things are reflecting sunlight back into space and resulting in cooling. And we know this from historical records, and we actually know it from art as well. So even art that emerged at the time of historical eruptions that have happened show us that there was cooling. So this graph, we're looking at the temperature decrease by the amount of sulfur aerosols. So more sulfur aerosols going this way, and this is showing you cooler. It's a little counterintuitive. As you go up, that means you're getting colder and colder and colder. We have historical eruptions. So these are ones that have happened during humans being on the scene. And as I mentioned, they play out in art. So in one case, in the Tambora eruptions in 1883, this was known as the year without a summer. There was no summer because it was so cold. There was a group of scholars, of writers, including Mary Shelley, who wasn't Mary Shelley at the time, but she was there with Percy Shelley, who became her husband, but wasn't her husband at the time. He was someone else's husband. There's always scandal and drama in these stories. And to express the angst of being no summer, it was cold and dark, and they were in Lake Geneva. It sounds romantic, but it was cold, dark, and in Lake Geneva for 2 years and no sunlight. She expressed her angst by creating the monster Frankenstein. Well, we also have Edward Monk's The Scream from Krakatoa eruption in 1815, and he wrote in his journal, again, no sun, no sunlight. Actually, this is showing you kind of a sunset, but the reason that it's red is because of what happens with these volcanic winters. You don't see normal things. He said that he stood on a bridge and opened his mouth and let out a scream, and that was the inspiration for his paintings. So volcanic eruptions, climate, the answer is also always climate. If it's not the Triassic, the answer is climate or it's environment. But what this tells us is that in these intervals, 2 year freezes, we said these are normal cone volcanoes. What we're talking about is the most massive destructive volcanic eruption in the entire solar system happened while dinosaurs rise. So actually the cooling is much, much more severe, so severe that on this map it's saying that from that cooling, you actually get frozen tropics, freezing temperatures in the tropics. Now this is like, whoa, mind blowing, how do you do that? And how do we know though? So that's the projection, it's in the tropics. But as Randy was saying, one of the beautiful, elegant things about science is about finding the truth whether you like it or not. You're truth seekers, you get to hypothesize, get a cool places, dig in the mud, come back to your lab and tell a story. Well, so our next story is we go to the Arctic of Pangaea to the Zhangar Basin in China, and we look to see if there's any evidence of freezing, right? Because the prediction is that you should have freezing, but we're actually gonna look at the high latitudes first just to see, because if it's frozen, well, it makes sense it's there because we know herbivorous dinosaurs are there. We have things like herbivorous dinosaur teeth, we have plants that are lush vegetation there, and this is all coming kind of from these beds right here in between coal deposits and seams. We also have a whole bunch of evidence of herbivorous dinosaurs, and they're in the exact same beds as our next line of paleosleuthing evidence, which comes in the form of ice-rafted debris. So lots of different types of herbivorous dinosaurs, big dinosaurs, but eating plants. And in those same exact deposits, we have, lo and behold, evidence of ice. Freezing temperatures as a result of massive volcanic activity. So what does this mean? I'm showing you a picture that has what I'm telling you. This is like the greatest evidence you've ever seen. You're going, I see some pebbles. And that's exactly right. These shouldn't be there. We're looking at a lake. The lake then would be settling out, and what should be at the bottom of the lake is mud, not grain-sized looking material like this. So we know that those grains did not come from the lake mud. They had to be carried from somewhere else. So there, what happened was there were bits of rock that freeze to the base of ice on the shoreline of these lakes. They hitch a ride with the ice, it drifts into the open water. Eventually, as that floating ice melts, the bits of rock actually sink and drop them to the bottom of the lake, deposited in their new territory. Those things that hijacked a ride, again, they don't belong there. They're in these bigger size fractions. It's evidence of this ice-rafted debris. So there actually was freezing temperatures in those high latitudes. There's another line of evidence that backs this up, and this is just looking at, well, what happens to plants as you go from the equator, the low tropics at 25 degrees north, as you go upward to the Arctic Circle. And all you need to take away from this is that the pattern doesn't look the same. We're just looking at things, these are Triassic, here's the extinction here, so half things get through in the low latitudes. And this one, as we're getting higher north, so we're going on this transect here, there's a less severe extinction as we get to the high latitudes, so that in this interval, the plants don't even experience this major mass extinction. That's a clue to us. Well, let's bring this story back to why we're here today, DinoFest, to the dinosaur story. So one of the most important features of the in-Triassic extinction is that dinosaurs, again, they'd evolved 30 million years earlier, but they weren't ecologically dominant. Remember we said they were 10%. There was a whopping potential 11%, maybe they were 11%, they were 10 or 11%, but minor components of the ecosystem. And instead we have these croc-lined archosaurs. So at the in-Triassic extinction, we have our really cool croc-lined things going extinct, all these really cool ones. And what gets through? Well, the three major groups of dinosaurs, the sauropods, the theropods, and the ornithischians, and then two little crocodile-lined creatures, one that goes on to become real crocodiles, the other one that ends up with no descendants. How did they get through? Well, they're sneaky little devils. They are naked, so they can't survive those cool cold blasts. Only dinosaurs and pterosaurs, because they have feathers. They burrow. So here are some examples of burrows, and here are some actually of some of the pseudosuchians that are actually fossilized in their burrow. So there's no doubt that they were making it, and we also have lots of footprints as well, suggesting that the early Jurassic, what was common in terms of the crocodile creatures, are all because they're burrowing. Now, if we look at this in a mapped out evolutionary tree, we're just looking at the types of organisms we're talking about. So the pseudosuchians, the crocodile-like creatures, the pterosaurs, the ornithischians, and then the line that is the sauropods and theropods leading to birds, we have protofeathers, so fuzz, at this stage here for the survivors, but outside of that are the naked creatures, the pseudosuchians, and they do not fare well at this mass extinction, we think because there are cold snaps. So again, different than what we thought. So the Jurassic world, we said, dinosaurs and pterosaurs thrive. Again, why did they survive? Well, why did they survive? Why do we have things like Jurassic Park? We said the clue is in these volcanoes. Here's a pterosaur, here's our Centaurus, our feathery dinosaur. Well, it's because they actually had Jurassic Parkas. Again, a little bit. And that lets them get through these cold snaps. So that brings us to the end of this story, that volcanic eruptions, well, they throw out the high, so much CO2, so much methane, undoubtedly. That's the highest CO2 since the dawn of animal life on our planet some 600 million years ago. There's cascading effects of volcanism. It's not just a warming story. Remember, it's a double whammy. It's warming for long periods, but it's cool snaps. Remember Frankenstein. Those volcanic winters, there's evidence for seasonal freezing. So there's actually as an evidence of ice in the Arctic. I showed you from our ice rafted debris. And it may be that the downy insulation gave dinosaurs an edge to outcompete their naked crocodile-lined competitors. So what's the take-home message here? Well, we're talking about an excellent natural experiment. We're talking about the late Triassic and we're talking about the end Triassic extinction. Dinosaur dominance was suppressed under high CO2, high climate extremes, wildfires in the tropics, crocodile-lined taxa are dominant because they are cold-blooded, not warm-blooded. Dinosaur survival at the in-Triassic, different than what we thought. It's because they're actually pre-adapted to cold conditions, shocking but true. And dinosaurs don't do in the world tropics. They did and do better in a world that actually has cold and warm regimes. So sometimes they like it cold, sometimes they like it hot. And that brings me to my acknowledgement. So several people who have been on part of these expeditions or assisted with lab work, and I'm happy to entertain any questions. Thank you. When the sulfur aerosols go into the atmosphere, they actually kind of result in ice crystals being made. They interact with water vapor in the upper parts of the atmosphere, and that basically forms like an ice crystal. Because the surface area is therefore different, it's a larger surface area, it actually results in something called an albedo effect, so it's reflecting sunlight coming in. The whole story about like climate on our Earth is what's called a radiative balance. So it's the amount of heat or insulation, heat coming in from the sun and what gets reflected back to space. And in this case, those sulfur aerosols are actually formed like a protective crystal layer that reflects back. In fact, it's so significant a drop that when we think about solutions for our current predicament, one thing people want to do is look at the Earth has been warmer, how does it naturally go down? Sulfur aerosols. People want to actually throw up sulfur aerosols into our atmosphere to allow for that material to go back to result in cooling on the Earth. So it's something called geomimicry, but it's a great question, but that's how it specifically works.
Something I'm wondering about is considering that we have prosauropods at both the northern and southern high latitude areas. Is there a way to figure out whether or not there was like any cold snaps that happened like earlier on in the late Triassic that would allow like the prosauropods to actually get across the inhospitable tropics from the one polar region to the other?
Right, that's a great question, and Randy and I used to joke about this, about why didn't the dinosaur cross the equator or pole or something. I can't remember how we made the chicken. So we know the evidence that we have. It's not to say that they didn't cross the pole. Possibly some of them did, and because we don't have as long a detailed record through the late Triassic, it's possible that we see that there is some evidence of cold snaps coming through. Possibly some of these other events, like even Manicouagan, there's actually a small cooling that can happen from bolide impacts. So it's a great question and one that's an active area of research.
Thank you. Do you see any changes in bone cross-sections, lamina, from cold weather to warm weather in the fossil record?
That's a great question. So there's definitely changes in terms of whether the metabolism is cold-blooded or warm-blooded, but I suppose there would be some minor change in terms of background climate changes because of an issue with like water retention. I don't know specifically how that would play out in the bones.
Because there was some earlier work done with varanid lizards where they were exercised in different temperature regimes, and they showed a striking difference in the laminar sections in long bones, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see that being the case because of, you know, just the way that the water would be retained and thresholds in terms of temperature.
Last chance, any other questions for Dr. Whiteside?
No,
she's not. So you need examples of polyaromatic hydrocarbons and pigments as molecular fossils. Are there any others that give us particular insights that could be new insights like the last couple of decades as these techniques have gained in popularity?
So specifically for wildfire or any kind of?
Just any.
Yeah, so there are lots of them. There's a new one that actually looks at whether an organism is warm or hot-blooded, or warm or cold-blooded, so that's a new kind of molecular fossil. But they're constantly new ones. Our lab has been working specifically also on some that are pigments in the ocean. So it turns out at this time, you know, when we think of the ocean, when you see it from an airplane, you see blue. Sometimes you see green if there's high photosynthesis, so lots of productivity. But actually, it turns out that the late Triassic and Triassic extinction oceans were purple. So there's a pigment that comes from something called purple sulfur bacteria. The story about the rise of dinosaurs is one of these beautiful things. That story of cooling on land and extinction is not the same story we see in the ocean. So I like to tell people it's like Hallberger's ride, where there was one if by land, two if by sea, when the redcoats were coming. On land, I think it was one cause of extinction is cooling. In the land, it's actually two dealing with warming. So the CO2 and the methane, the heat trapping gases, they result in ocean acidification. So if you've ever seen like a cavity, it's basically that kind of thing, but killing everything that's calcifying in the ocean. And then alongside of that is low oxygen conditions. And those low oxygen conditions mean that it's stripping green bacteria. And if you don't have green bacteria, you often get purple. So if you were to see a bird's eye view of the Jurassic, it would be purple ocean from these pigments from purple sulfur bacteria that would be the only things proliferating in the wake of things like ichthyosaurs and different kinds of fish. So, and there are lots of biomarker work. You know, it's an ongoing area of research. I find it really fascinating. I mentioned earlier today that I started my idea of paleontology at the skeletal level, and all the questions I started asking were like, oh, and why this, why that? I found myself getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until it was actually a molecule. So.
I'm just curious as how long the timeline of this type of science, because when I was young, I was taught or told that dinosaurs walked and they dragged their tails. And they also thought that maybe there was a brain in the front and a brain in the back. So all this getting down in the like, how long has this science been going on?
Yeah, I think it gets revisited all the time. So, you know, when I was learning about dinosaurs in high school, I was learning, you know, that they dragged their tails. I was learning that they were reptilian, not the bird connection. I was learning that they only liked hot, steamy conditions. And so it's so exciting when you're at the forefront and really changing the way that we think about things, because science is like so dynamic and so constantly changing, and it's so beautiful because it's like anything you know about any specific field whatsoever will help you in your scientific discoveries. Even the idea of like just taking a fresh perspective and revisiting these things. So yeah, I would say in the last 10 years we fundamentally, or maybe 20 years, we fundamentally turned over everything we thought about dinosaurs.
Okay.
I'm just really interested in this idea of like molecular paleontology, and like when you use the analogy of like an espresso machine. So when you, because last year somebody was talking about metabolic things they'd learned from looking at molecules. This is a very basic question, but like, are you like looking at the molecules through a microscope, or are you getting chemical information?
Oh, that's a great question. So the we do look at something through the microscope, the pollen and spores. The actual molecules, they're so small, we can't actually look under a microscope. So we use instrumentation that are called gas or liquid chromatography, and is connected to mass spectrometers, that basically looks at the kind of atomic weight or the mass of something relative to something else, and that's how you get intensity peaks. But it's a great question. When we're extracting through the fancy espresso machines, we're pulling out all the fat molecules there. And then the next thing we do is we have, it actually looks a little rudimentary. We have some columns that are set up, and they work just like paper chromatography. If you remember from high school, maybe, that you had a piece of paper and you would drop something on it, and through time, different things would come, for different colors would come through your paper. It's that same principle, but we're using solvents, just like if anyone likes to drink, that's alcohol as a solvent. We use different kinds of solvents, and they have different kind of densities, and they pull out different compounds. And once we have those compounds, we do a few more laboratory tricks. We inject it actually with a needle, and we take that needle and we inject it into mass spectrometers that look at the different weights and then tell us how abundant one molecule is to another.
Right. Thank you. Good. Thank you, Greta.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. I'm glad to kind of close the discussion by talking about new horizons in paleontology with Dr. Whiteside, and also about how science is an ever-changing process with new discoveries. I see some proto-paleontologists out here that might be up here talking to us one day at a future Dino Fest. So please join me again in thanking Dr. Jessica Whiteside and Dr. Randy Ernst, our keynote speakers.